Hi everyone, my name is Annika. Thank you for joining this video today. Today I'm going to be walking us through a sample Chem Phys passage, and this passage is going to be all about bonds and bonding interactions. So if you have questions on this subject matter, keep watching, and hopefully I'll provide some information that might help answer similar questions if you get them on your test. So just before we start, I wanted to say that normally for Chem Phys passages, I like to spend about 8-ish minutes on each passage, but today, since I'm going to be walking through it very in depth and talking out loud, it will take a little bit longer. But yeah, my general strategy for attacking a Chem Phys passage when it comes up is to just do a, you know, first pass read through of it. Anytime I see a keyword, I'll tend to underline or highlight it and start to think about, you know, bring to my memory some like concepts or facts about it, about that particular concept that I probably want to be remembering from content review. Whenever I see a figure in a Chem Phys passage in my first read through of it, I don't like to spend too much time going through all of the details of it, but I do like to sort of understand just like big picture what they're showing me, what the main idea is of the figure or table or picture or whatever they're showing. And then usually I'll dive deeper into it if a question requires me to when I get there. So yeah, without further ado, let's get started. I'm just gonna start reading it. So the first paragraph reads, near infrared fluorescent proteins, NIR FPs, are large molecules used to image tissues and cell populations in vivo. NIR imaging has been found to be optimal for imaging mammalian tissue due to the existence of an optical transparency window in which light absorption and scattering appear to be minimized. So I'm already noticing light absorption. That's kind of a big picture topic that's like causing me to remember things about like waves and light. Using near-infrared fluorescence allows optical probing of tissue at multiple depths, enabling whole-body imaging. A subclass of bright monomeric NIR FPs, known as MIRFP proteins, contain two specially developed domains, a PAS domain and a GAF domain, which may form a portion of the protein binding pocket. Okay, so here we're being introduced to these molecules. They have particular domains. We might be asked about the chemical structure of that later. And they're part of the protein binding pocket. Okay, so now I'm starting to think about why certain things might be binding to a protein binding pocket. There might be certain characteristics of that pocket that make it more favorable for particular types of molecules to bind versus others. Okay, moving forward, biliverdin is a tetrapyrrole chromophore that fluoresces upon stimulation and may be covalently linked to NIR FPs to provide fluorescence. The degree, brightness, and quality of the fluorescence is directly affected by efficiency of biliverdin binding. Okay, I don't know how to pronounce that, to be honest. But anyways, we're learning that this is something that can be stimulated and fluoresce, and we know that that's a common type of tagging procedures that we've seen in various places in MCAT content. And the quality of the fluorescence is based on binding. So this means that you can use this as a measurement of binding, potentially binding affinity. Researchers wish to understand the nature of biliverdin binding. To do so, a molecule of unbound BV is exposed to an MIRFP. Several MIRFP proteins were selected for binding. In this family, MIRFP 670 is the most blue-shifted and holds a high significance of multicolor NIR imaging. Okay, so blue shifted means it probably has something to do with its absorption or transmittance of light at the blue wavelengths. It is hypothesized that cysteine residues on the molecule contribute to the rigidity of the BV bound structure, thus increasing fluorescent yield. Okay, so they particularly called attention to cysteine residues, and because we have to memorize the amino acids for the MCAT, I'm recalling that cysteine has a SH group, a thiol group, which makes it one of the amino acids that's able to create sulfide bonds with other cysteine residues. So that might have something to do with the binding pocket. Okay, now we're getting into the figure. At first glance, it looks pretty complicated. We see it has multiple parts. Part A looks like it's showing us the structure of BV. Okay, so that's interesting. At first glance, I'm noticing some rings, some double bonds, carboxylic acids, some some nitrogens, and it looks like when you add an apoprotein, you're beginning to see these MIRFPs that they're talking about. They are shown in different colors. This potentially has something to do with the shifts. We know that one of them was blue shifted 670. Okay, and again, we can notice some key features of the structure, some functional groups. We see aromatic rings again, carbonyls, amides, that kind of thing. Okay, if we're looking at figure B, we see some kind of spectra where we are plotting absorption of these different compounds. So we have unbound BV, and then we have the introduction of these different MIRFPs that they talked about, and the structures of those are on the side. Just looking at this graph, I'm not going to look too deeply into the patterns, but we see that on the x-axis we have wavelength, and we know that different wavelengths mean different frequencies of light as well. As we increase wavelength, we decrease frequency. And then we also see absorbance on the y-axis. And so we see that there's some peaks here in wavelength. We notice that the unbound has a much greater peak than the other MIRFPs. Okay, researchers monitored the binding reaction in real time as the process occurred over a time period of minutes to tens of minutes. The resulting bound structures were analyzed using computational methods. It was determined that BV undergoes isomerization, localization to a binding pocket on the apoprotein, protonation, and rearrangement of intermolecular binding. Okay, so those are four things that happen to this BV molecule. Maybe one of the questions will be about how that relates to the BV molecule structure. Okay, so overall we have an idea of what this BV molecule is, how it can be tagged for fluorescence and measured in absorption spectra, that kind of thing. Okay, now let's get into the questions. Number one, which of the following bonds are most likely to be formed between two adjacent MIRFP molecules? Okay, so right off the bat, I'm seeing two adjacent MIRFP molecules, and so we have seen in the figure they gave us what the structures look like. Because we're looking at two adjacent molecules, we are going to be looking specifically for intermolecular forces. And so right off the bat, we might be thinking about some of examples of those, like hydrogen bonding. But let's look at the answer choices to see which ones contain the true answers. Okay, so if we look at A, we see the first thing is covalent bonding. Is covalent bonding an intermolecular force? The answer is no. Covalent bonds are examples of interatomic forces, and because we have two separate molecules that are just kind of interacting with each other, we're going to eliminate A because covalent bonds are not intermolecular. Okay, we also can eliminate C for that reason. Okay, now if we look at answer choice B, we see a similar thing where we're looking at ionic in this answer choice. Again, for the same reason we were talking about earlier, ionic bonds are not intermolecular forces. They are interatomic forces between like a positively and negatively charged ion in which electrons are being given away or taken up. So we're going to eliminate B for that reason. Then we are left with answer choice D. Just to dive into this a little bit deeper, just to confirm, can two MIRFP molecules form hydrogen bonds? If we look at the structure, yes, we see plenty of donors and acceptors. Here's an example of a donor, acceptor. So yes, there definitely could be interactions between the two molecules on the level of hydrogen bonding. Van der Waals interactions, that's kind of a freebie. Theoretically, any two molecules can interact with each other in van der Waals interactions. So that's for sure, yes. And dipole-dipole, that just means that there needs to be dipole moments, there needs to be moments of electronegativity in these molecules, and we definitely see that. Like this carboxylic acid group has plenty of electronegativity. The amides as well have periods of electronegativity. So there are definitely dipole moments that would create opportunities for interaction. And a good rule of thumb is that dipole-dipole bonds, if there are hydrogen bonds, there are also likely dipole-dipole bonds because hydrogen bonding relies on a type of dipole where you have some kind of electronegative atom and a hydrogen, which is not electronegative at all. Okay, number two. According to the data presented in the passage, how many pi bonds exist in the BV molecule? Okay, so if we're thinking about how two atoms bind together, the first bond they make is going to be called a sigma bond, and any bond they make in addition to that will be a pi bond, and that is based on hybridization. So we're basically going to be looking at any kinds of double bonds in this molecule. So let's look over at the BV molecule, which they gave us its structure, and count the bonds. Okay, let me zoom in. So we see one, oh my god, that's too big. Okay. We see 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13. Okay, so that's just the double bonds between the carbons and then the aromatic rings that are shown in the picture. However, I do want to point out that it's really easy to miss that these are actually carboxylic acids. And we know that carboxylic acids take a structure that look like this, where the R group is like this whole area. And in these, we do see a double bond. So we also need to add two for the double bond here and here for these two carboxylic acids. So given that, we have 15 total pi bonds, and that is an answer choice, so we're going to go with that. Okay, which of the following best describes the bonds within the BV molecule? Okay, so we have, looking at the answer choices, we're going to be deciding between covalent and ionic, and it looks like they have descriptions of each. So right away, let's eliminate the answer choices in which the word up front does not match the description after it. So covalent, the atoms involved are nonmetals with different electronegativities resulting in electron exchange. The other option for covalent is that the atoms involved are nonmetals with similar electronegativities resulting in electron sharing. So if we remember correctly, an example of a covalent bond would be like a C double bonded to a C, or C bonded to a C. We see that in the BV molecule. That sounds like similar electronegativity and electron sharing, not necessarily electron exchange. So I'm going to go ahead and eliminate A. Electron exchange is more characteristic of ionic bonds. So for example, NaCl, where one is extremely more electronegative than the other. Cl is way more electronegative. And it basically like unequally takes Na's electrons. So along that same vein of logic, we are going to eliminate answer choice D because ionic bonds do not have electron sharing. They have electron exchange. Okay, so now we're down to B and C, and basically we have to decide, are these bonds ionic or covalent? If we look in the molecule, we definitely see like a lot of aromatic rings, carbons bonded to other carbons, lots of carbon chains, carbons bonded to nitrogens, carbons bonded to oxygens. We don't really see any metals involved, and because of that, I'm going to go ahead and say that this is covalent bonding. Another key thing to note is that there's nothing really charged here in this BV molecule, and that's usually a hallmark of ionic bonding. Okay, number four. In preparation for the experiment, scientists have successfully isolated and purified MIRFPs. Which of the following should MIRFPs be stored in to minimize damage and denaturing? Okay, so how should they be stored? Basically, the key to storing something and having it not get too messed up is you want to store it in something that is similar to it. If you store it in something that is way too charged, it will end up denaturing the molecule. So for example, if we think about protein denaturing, a big way that we do that is we add HCl to it, because HCl is incredibly acidic and it completely messes up the environment and the quaternary structure of a protein. So we want something that's very similar to MIRFP that's not really going to damage it too much. Our first choice is HCl, that will neutralize any bases. Okay, HCl does neutralize bases. However, there aren't really any super basic parts of the BV molecule, and we do know that HCl is a very powerful denaturing agent. Along the same vein, we have sodium hydroxide, which might neutralize any acids that might affect BV. Okay, it's true, NaOH does neutralize acids. However, it's an incredibly strong base, very, very charged, and that might mess up some of these groups here, like the carboxylic acid and that kind of thing. So I'm going to go ahead and eliminate answer choice B because that's a really powerful base. C, methane. Methane won't interact with BV, preserving its structure. Okay, so methane is incredibly nonpolar. It's just going to be carbons and hydrogens. It's true, this is potential, like it won't be charged and it won't like protonate or deprotonate the molecule. However, this may mess with some of the like dipoles and hydrogen bonding that we have seen in the BV molecule that is able to happen. Okay, if we look at glycerol, glycerol is not completely nonpolar. It does have a lot of nonpolar parts, but it does have the ability to hydrogen bond with BV. So if we're looking between C and D at which one is most like BV, the answer is D, because methane is just simply too nonpolar. Glycerol does have a little bit of hydrogen bonding capability, which will complement the BV well and preserve its ability to hydrogen bond in the future. Okay, finally, number five. What are the possible molecular hybridizations of a carbon atom located within a pyrrole ring labeled as B? Okay, so if we look at the BV molecule, or if we just look at any of the molecules with the pyrrole rings labeled B, just take a look at it and we see that it is an aromatic ring. So we have a carbon right here. It is bond to how many things? One thing here, two things here, three things. It's bonded to three things. So we want to think about what its hybridization is. We will say it is SPP. So that is an SP2 carbon that we are looking at. And if we look at the answer choices, SP2 is one of the choices, so we're going to go ahead and go with that. Okay, I hope this was super helpful, thinking through bonding and bonding interactions. Please feel free to email me with any questions if any of my explanations didn't make sense. Additionally, explanations for all these answer choices are on the website, so go ahead and check that out if you want more detail. But yeah, thanks for watching and happy studying!